from all, to all, with all, for all, through all, we thank the gods of creation. We thank the ancestors. We thank the forces of nature. And we thank the earth. We thank them for their direction, their protection, their guidance, for keeping us, showing us, allowing us to know and enjoy life to its fullest, now and later.
Black people want love, but the slow march of time. Time is hard to hold in the soft, low-born chambers of our hearts. And what's we, the half-fooled mommies and daddies of a sun world, but turn our strands of hair into antennas to tune in the juju madness and syncopated love rhythms of Africa. And we love with time, and we took the time to love, and with the right time we love, and we love time after time. Will we ever love again? Will we ever love again? Will we really ever love again? Or will we just sit and rot away with the brighter tomorrows in the skag field, rat-cluttered halls of our minds?
Black people, what y'all gonna do? Black people, what y'all gonna do?
Will the real black people please stand up?
Every day, every night, I had to fight. Had to stay on my grind to try to change my life. The life didn't go my way, but that's okay. It made me the man I am today. If you ever seen a struggle, no father, no mother, lost your sister, a brother, your heart been broke by a lover, and you need something to help ease your pain, then pour your heart out and let me hear your song.
I'm living in these dark streets,
dark streets, dark streets.
No friends, just enemies. The devil trying to get to me, but I stay grinding constantly, constantly. No friends or no family. Told me what I couldn't be, but I kept my faith in G-O-D, G-O-D, yeah.
No matter where you're from, how rich or poor you are, if you're a lawyer, doctor, preacher, drug dealer, we all have lived and seen some dark days, some bad times. Funny thing is that these dark streets, they don't care about how much money you got.
I dare not speak without first asking for permission from the elders. So humble myself at the honorable mention of those who have fought and or died for the liberation of African people, whether on the continent or in the diaspora. Realizing that at this present moment in time, we need them more than we ever have before. And I am not ashamed of the contributions that they have made. So I call on them.
John Henry Clark, Dr. Ben, Queen Ashantiwa.
If you are not ashamed of what they have done for you, then call on them.
Khalil Muhammad, Malcolm X, Nat Turner.
If you are in need of the power and strength that they possess, then call on them.
Ferguson, Denmark, VC, KB,
Apostle. If you are in need of encouragement and guidance from them, then call on them.
Robert Williams, King Hannibal, Queen Ashantiwa, Nefertiti, Ashe, Ashe.
It's finished.
Ashe.
Ancestors woke me up this morning. They said, son, you do know what time it is, don't you? I said, what time is that? They said, it's war time. So welcome to the war front, brothers and sisters. Give yourselves a round of applause for coming on out here this evening. Want to thank everybody for coming out. Also want to give a special shout. I don't know anybody who's been counting, but after this weekend, let's see, we got the feminization of the black male reloaded, the journey to Ahmed, we got I'm conscious now what, and we got two more today. Has anybody noticed that there's a pattern of where we do our new lectures? It just so happens that whenever we're filming a new lecture live and we want that right energy for it, that means you got to have the right energy today. When we got that right energy, we come on down here to Virginia. My family was born and raised, and we came up in Emporia, Virginia. I was born and raised in Washington, D.C., but all of my roots are in Emporia, Virginia. This is Nat Turner country down here. So when we want to come on down and have serious dialogue and get the right energy, we come on here down to Virginia. So can we show some special love for my brother Omek and my sister Drea for putting together the House of Nat Turner in 2015, where black people can come together and discuss our issues like we used to do on the sidebar on the plantation and figure out what we're going to do to fix ourselves and our community and our condition. Let's show them some love for the House of Consciousness here in Northern Virginia. All right. I want to let everybody know, if you want to stay in touch with us after you hear what you hear today, you can always listen to us on the Straight Black Pride Movement Radio, which is on Blog Talk. Blogtalkradio.com/ SBPM, Straight Black Pride Movement. We have our One Horizon program, 7 to 10 p.m. every Monday, Eastern Standard Time, so you can tune in and listen. You can also go back and listen to the older programs that we had. And very soon, we're going to have our Northeast Regional Chapters going to be doing a program on our blog talk on Thursday nights. So we're going to be filling up the whole station, the Straight Black Pride Movement, with different programming that can help uplift the consciousness of African people. Also, tomorrow, we're going to have a very different type of discussion. There's a very uplifting, powerful discussion about Straight Black Pride Movement. Not what we think we should do, but what we're doing and what we're going to do to pull our people out of this condition for the 21st century. So we ask that you come on back out. Now I want to make a disclaimer. When we originally decided to do this discussion called possession or possessed, you know, you come up with an idea of things that you want to get a point across. But as we began to do it, we began to see how intense and in-depth this discussion and how serious it is. So what I want to say is, we apologize for anybody that brought children. And if you're at home, this is not one for the children. And in fact, what we're going to discuss today is so deep and so intense that at any time, if it's too much for you, I would ask you to go ahead. It's not a problem if you want to step out the room or whatever the case may be, because we're going into the depth of the problems faced by African people in the world we're in. We're going deeper than we've ever gone before. And you can always come back tomorrow if you will focus on what to do to uplift everything. You want your children and family. Tomorrow's the day. Straight Black Pride Movement. Today is the day that we go deeper than we've ever gone. So I would suggest, if you have not watched the Effeminization of the Black Male series or the Effeminization of the Black Male Reloaded and the Genocide Lecture, and the sexual warfare lecture, and Dear Obama, and Fighting the Poltergeist. If you have not watched the Racism and White Supremacy course, and Feminism and the Making of the Black Widow, Feminism, Lesbianism, Making of the Black Widow. If you haven't watched Secret Relationship Between Black Small Hats and Black Leaders. If you have not watched Black on Black Self-Hatred, very critical. And if you have not watched Black Degeneracy versus Black Nationalism, and finally, if you have not watched Death by Lethal Integration and I'm Conscious Now What, I would suggest, if you're watching this on tape and you started at this point, I would suggest you do those first. Not any one of them, but in conjunction with one another. Because today is not the day where we spend time proving the points. The documentation is there in each of these things. I don't have time to spend 8 hours going through entertainment here today. We've already done that. You want the proof? It's in the documents that we've already created. But today, we're going to talk about the psychology of what we're dealing with. So if you have this under your belt, you will understand it. If you have not seen anything we've done before, a lot of what you hear today may not make sense, and you might not be able to appreciate it the way we would like for you to be able to appreciate it. So we want to put that disclaimer out to let people know that at this point. So we're going to get into this discussion today called Possessed. Very, very serious discussion. The most intense and serious and in-depth discussion that we as One Horizon have ever done. So I want everybody to take a deep breath now, because if you've seen any of the other ones that we've done, I left one out, but there are predators in our midst. That is a must and a prerequisite before you watch this as well. If you haven't gone through that one, what you're going to see today is going to be extremely heavyweight. What is possession? Possession is the state of being controlled or dominated by, or as if by, evil spirits. You know, some of us have seen The Exorcist. It's that point where the individual has the physical body that belongs to them, but the things that inside that drive what they are doing, the ideas, the personality, the things that drive them and push them to move do not belong to them. In particular, we talk about African people, it is black people who have the shell of black people. We have our hair and our legs and our ideas and things of that nature, but the ideas on the inside that are driving our behavior, the taste that we have, the things we find funny, the way we interact with the world, the way we talk to each other are not being driven by who we will be naturally as Africans. There's another personality that has been injected and is taking control of us as a people and have us acting in a manner totally out of the character of who we are as a race of people. So does everybody understand what we're talking about when we're saying possessed? I can't hear you. Yeah. I'm in nobody. This is not Turner country. Let me, y'all understand?
Yeah.
All right, let's go now. Now, this is one of our greatest psychologists that we've ever produced. Let's show some love for Dr. Amos Wilson. Peace be upon him. Brilliant black man. One of the things that Dr. Amos Wilson told us is that in order to defend oneself against possession, what one must have is a clear identity. One of the best defenses, in other words, when we know who we are, we understand our history, our culture, what we're supposed to be doing, what we're supposed to be striving towards, it is difficult for someone to implant foreign ideas into us because we already know who we are and we will reject them. So let's take a listen to Brother Amos Wilson as he kind of breaks it down for us a little bit.
That is the separation of African people from their African selves, from their basic African identities. When you have an identity, it is difficult for another person to impose a set of values on you. Because having a positive identity and a solid identity is a defense against being penetrated by alien forces. A positive identity functions to locate us in the world, in space, and in time, and in history. A positive identity gives us a sense of purpose and a sense of direction. A positive identity provides us with self-knowledge and direction. A positive identity provides us with a sense of belongingness. When we say we are African, we are not merely identifying ourselves as individuals. We indicate that we belong to a people, to a culture, to a nation, that we belong to a system of values, a system of perceptions, a system of behavior, folkways and mores. A system, an identity permits us to cooperate with other people. It permits us to understand what role we must play within a particular group. An identity permits us to know our own interests. An identity permits us to provide ourselves with an evaluative system, permits us to evaluate what is going on in the world. An identity prevents us, provides us with a defense against possession. I've often said that we cannot be African and be slaves and subordinates of other people at the same time. We cannot be fully identified and at one with our African identity and be subordinate to another people. The European, of course, recognized this immediately. That is why when we talk about our slave history, we often talk about the destruction of African culture. We talk about the rewriting of black history as an attempt, again, of destroying the African culture and an African personality. We recognize that the destruction of that personality, the separating of us from our culture, the separating of us from our history, is a separation of us ultimately from our identity. It means a split and a schism is created in the personality. When a schism and a split is created in the personality, the individual is made exceedingly uncomfortable.
So our brother, Dr. Amos Wilson, is telling us, in order for us to prevent this, the best defense against this possession is for us to know who we are. And when that is taken from us knowing who we are, our history and our culture, it makes it very easy for other foreign ideas to be inserted into our minds. If we want to understand who we are, there's no better place. I don't believe in trying to do that which has been done the best already again. No reason to duplicate the effort. The master teacher Ashraquazi and Mama and the Queen, Mama Murray Raquazi, together with Kemetnu, KEMETNU.com. The information they have put together on the history and the culture of African people is, in my opinion, the best place for the modern education of African people to find our identity. There's a lot of different materials, but if you go to this one place, you go order their videos, you watch them. Once you watch them once, you're gonna watch them over and over again, because the history of our people that has been stolen from us, the culture of our people that has been stolen from us, that which we have never learned, They give it to us and they show you, so there's no confusion as to whether it's the truth, and you begin to see the world in completely new paradigms. And they have provided the information for us. And it's as simple as taking up money that we've earned, purchasing it, watching it, sharing with our children, and it instantly begins to recalibrate our mind, make us feel better about ourselves so that we can make progress and go in the right direction. One in particular DVD that I tell people has had tremendous impact on me. In fact, the basis for all the discussions, even this one, that we do at One Horizon, was this particular DVD. It's called Christianity, the Stolen Religion from Africa. It's the part two, how the enemy became the deity. And in the process he used for educating African people in this one is where all of the wealth of the material that you see in One Horizon was taken from. That style of teaching and educating for the 21st century is what we believe can liberate the minds of African people. So we ask you again to support KemetNew.com to find your African identity. Why is an identity important? It tells us how men, the black man, are supposed to relate with women, the black woman. It tells us how we're supposed to treat one another, how we're supposed to feel when we see each other. A racial identity tells us how we view our children, how we view our families. It tells us what clothes we wear. It tells us what colors we like. It tells us what foods we like. It tells us what, you know, how we view the world in terms of whether we're group people or we individualistic people. It tells us how we feel about our grandparents and others before us. And it is important for us to know the history of our families. What made them migrate from where they came to where they ended up? What made grandpa pick grandma to marry her? It's important for us to know these stories about our people, because what happens is many times we have anger or resentment or a negative feeling towards our family because we don't know the circumstances that led our family to be where they are. And without that information, it makes it difficult to understand why the family functions a certain way, which makes it even more difficult to figure out how to make the adjustment. Also, without a proper knowledge of the history of our family, a lot of times there are things our family that have done is great, and those things are forgotten and not passed down. So that's motivation and drive and encouragement that we miss out on in life simply because we don't know what the family has done. But a racial identity is also important because as African people, we exist all around the world. But when we come in contact with one another, if we do not have a racial identity, then we have no basis for the conversation and communication to understand that we're facing the same thing here. We may be speaking a different language. We may eat slightly different foods, but at the end of the day, we all like music. We all like family. We all want a happy, joyful life. We all like, you know, we like to sit down and laugh and joke. And we have the same warm spirit around the world, and we are facing the same enemies and the same assaults. But because many of us don't have a racial identity, we see a brother or sister, that's all it is an African that ended up here, we ended up there. Instead of seeing it as a brother or sister, we see them as a foreign entity because we don't share racial identities. Critical. Racial identity tells us how to feel when we see a black man with a black woman and black children. It tells us who we are. And in the spirit of this, because we didn't come here to actually talk about a racial identity today. You can find that again with Kim and New Know Thyself. However, we do have in our DVD, I'm Conscious Now What, more information about the importance of a racial identity and some more information in there about that. But today, what we want to do before we have this discussion, because as African people around the world, we are so inundated with filth and degeneracy and European ideas, and we're saturated with these foreign concepts, it's difficult for us to be able to look at black stuff and determine what's really black or was black and is possessed. So it's black on the outside, but something else on the inside. It is hard to tell because we have the same rhythm dancing, whether it's African spirituality or we act like a bunch of whores. It's the same rhythm, but there's a different spirit on it. So what I'm gonna do here, what we're gonna do, we're just gonna take 10 minutes as African people, and we're gonna just take a look. This is a microcosm of that African spirit and culture that still exists in our people around the world, and it's a microcosm, a snapshot of what the world for black people would look like if we did not have other races enslaving and otherwise assaulting our people. In other words, this is a snapshot of African people and culture in our right African mind that still exists today in pieces around the planet. We just gonna put some of them together today to get us feel for African culture, so as we talk about the possession, we have something to compare it to. Y'all all right?
Yeah.
Let's take this quick 10 minutes and get back into being black.
So what is the you? I try to say needing you when you don't really love me like you say you do. No, 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 no. You don't love me like you say you do. No, 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 no.
I bet I start shining. Tired of being broke and being poor. Rapping and wanting more. Standing down here in the subway when I should be on tour. Living in Inglewood when I should stay by Lake Shore. Every day I be fighting and I don't know what it's for. Why am I in the war? I don't even understand me. Out here rapping every day to try to feed my family. I should be in Miami somewhere winning Grammy. But I still struggle every day. God damn it. Gotta be a cold life I'm living in. Going through these problems every day. Trying to be an upright citizen, y'all don't even notice me. Since I'm broken on the streets, spitting poetry, they don't throw no dope for me. They tell me hopelessly, one day you gon' shine. But I guess I'm not there yet, cause it probably ain't my time. It's younger cats that feel like they better than this young man that stay up late night like his name was David Letterman. You got the key to the door that you need to let him in. I got a flow to remember, you never forget again. I'm in your head, fix your headache like some medicine. Yo, my last name should be Solo, etc.
Bodega Corners.
Dick Cheney.
Hey, brother, I'll explain it. He's not that brainy. Yo, screw Dick Cheney. Hey, that's right. Yeah, cause it's resident. That's why he was only homeboy the second president. Don't have no elements. Yeah, I could see. As far as I can be, what's the necro that I free?
Supercilious.
Yeah, when I'm feeling this off the top of the dome, I freestyle supercilious. Yeah, every time that I could rock it, yo, I'm feeling this. Microphones never fabricated, yo, I'm killing this. Break it down into parts, then I start rebuilding this. What's the next word that I could build in this drilling this?
Exponential.
Yeah, exponential. Every time that I rock it with all of my potential. Hey, that's right, yeah, and I could bounce it. Maybe I said it wrong, or maybe I mispronounced it, but it...
I know.
dancing as unto. I see that you dancing as unto. You dancing as unto. So what is a lingo?
To deal with the fact this stuff's not easy to swallow. So I'm sure you can see at this point why we say we don't want children to watch this. Because even adults, there's some other things you can have before you get here to be able to carry the weight from this. Because once you understand this, if you properly understand it and leave with this, you can never turn this off. You now, no longer can we have the debate or argument, are they good whites or the bad white folk? Because now, well, we all the same underneath the skin. You'd be like, well, maybe you like the white folks underneath the skin, but not me. Is it good white folks? Which part of them is good? Misogyny, rape, homosexuality, pedophilia, bestiality, sadomasochism, cannibalism, racial and white supremacy, genocide. Which part is good? Because that's ultimately underneath those soulless, glossy blue eyes that you look into and that smile, that's what's underneath. So let's go back into this conversation. What? How do they get in to possess our people, being as though we're physically able to walk around freely and make choices, right? We got choices as black people. So let's talk about, since we have choices and we don't see the physical shackles, how do they get in to gain possession of the physical African to turn us into the living, breathing reflection of Europeanism in black skin? How does it happen? The gateway. You know how when you walk into, you know, one of the big homes and it has a big gate? Walk into the gate, now you're on the property. You're no longer on the neutral ground. You're now on the property. You're not in the house yet, but you're on the property. The gateway to possession is entertainment. And if you get the video, Entertainment Fighting the Poltergeist, it's a three-parter. What's so good about that? It step by step teaches you exactly who created entertainment, why, when. It shows you, once you finish watching it, you understand how ideas are put together to get results. Once you do that, you can no longer turn on television and be confused. How many people have seen the three-part entertainment series? Raise your hands, please. Would you agree that once you watch the entertainment course, you'll never look at media the same again?
Yeah.
All right, all right, all right. So, don't have time to get into the depth of it, but we do need to understand some basic things, to see how do they possess our spirits? How do they take us from who we are and make us into something else? They get us to laugh at things that are painful and dangerous. When there is danger or pain, people do not find it funny. In order to change and begin the process of possession, they love to use comedy. What is comedy? Comedy is a tool used by Europeans to remove the sacredness of black traditions and values in order to replace them with European concepts, values, and practices. Say it again. We love our mothers and we take mothers to be sacred. You know, brother whoop your behind chasing about his mama. You talk about his father all day, you talk about his mama, he gonna be a problem. So they take the mother and they make you laugh at that principle and no longer is mother valuable. Your relationship between a brother and a sister, we love those relationships. We want that. They make our relationships look terrible and they make us laugh at them. They take the things that mean the most to us, our enslavement, anything that has value and is sacred, and make us laugh at it so it no longer has the same value. We don't take it seriously. Now they can put something.
I often think, how did comedy start? You know, like, who was the first black comic? You know what I mean? It probably started on a slave ship or something.
Reading slaves. Look alive! It
In order to make the middle passage a more pleasurable experience, the SS Echinacea is proud to present a comic. So please put your hands together and welcome one of your own, Ikali Nakapatulu. Pump it up, pump it up.
Keep it going. Hey, let's give it up for the MC. He really whoops ass, don't he? Literally, whoops ass. Is anybody from out of town? You know, I just swam in from Nairobi, and boy, are my arms tired. But seriously, folks, I hope I'm funny, because if y'all don't laugh, they're going to castrate me. Again. But you know what, folks? The great thing about dating a girl on a slave ship, you never have to worry about getting the drawers off. And speaking of drawers, you know, you think if somebody could afford to buy a human being, couldn't they afford some clothes to go along with it? I mean, do we all have to be half butt naked up in here? Damn! Put the lantern on this fool over here. Look at him, picking his lock. Hey, yo, what ship you think you on? The Army Star? You ain't going nowhere. If one more sailor rapes me, I swear I'm gonna throw myself overboard. I mean, can I at least get some romance, a little atmosphere, a glass of hard cider by candlelight, something? But you know what? I can't wait to get to the new world, because I can see me now in the big house with Massa's daughter. Platter, 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 platter! I see the light. Okay, look here. That looks like that's my time. I gotta get up out of here. Peace and chicken grease. See ya.
Now, once you just, you saw it. We're talking about psychology, man. Obviously, every one of those black folks, not just David Allen Greer, every single one of them is empty on the inside and has no relationship with their ancestors, with our ancestors who went through this, and no relationship to our future generations, because they're making fun out of the greatest atrocity in the history of the human experience. And they're talking about the most ugly elements of it, the rape of black men. And it's funny. And I'm not saying that the rape of black men is worse than the rape of black men, but I'm saying we can understand that for the male to have that taken from him is just an unfathomable idea for the black male. And for a male to be making fun of that. See, there's emptiness inside. It's a hollow place. Where once it's hollow, even the ones sitting there clapping and half naked and jiving, it means that each of them is an African shell that is empty, where the Euro can come and say, do this, do that, and offer money, and they will be able to do it because there's no connection with them with the identity of the ancestors, our ancestors who went through that. So hence, it's nothing desecrating about it. They just making money. And we say, well, we know that a small hat crafted this up, very likely, but what happens, I want you to hear this because this is important. When Africans are possessed, even in the absence of the European, the desire to do what the European would have us to do is so great that sometimes the physical European doesn't even have a presence. So like on your job, sometimes you got a Negro who is so possessed with the spirit of their enslavement that the whites don't even have a problem with you.
My ancestors woke me up this morning. They say, son, you do know what time it is, don't you? I said, what time is that? They said, it's war time. So welcome to the war front, brothers and sisters. Please give yourselves another round of applause for being here. This is going to be a very serious discussion. In fact, I'm going to go on a limb, which I don't think is a limb, and say this is the most important discussion for black people anywhere in the world right now in the 21st century. As we get into it, we'll understand we're not just here to talk about one incident. We're here to talk about the future of African people. So for people that want to stay in touch with us and know how to follow the information that we're providing and sharing with brothers and sisters, you can go to our website, waronthehorizon.com. You can also email us at liberation@waronthehorizon.com. We have our cards available here on the table, so you can get our cards so you can stay in touch with us. Also, we have a radio program on blogtalkradio.com/SBPM. That's Straight Black Pride Movement. Again, blogtalkradio.com/SBPM for Straight Black Pride Movement. Comes on Tuesdays through Thursday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. We're also expecting to get another program on Sunday nights, Brother Darren Muhammad, which would be phenomenal as well. But right now, it's Tuesday through Thursday, 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. You can get it anywhere in the world. So we want you to stay in touch with us to know what we're doing. Also, the easiest way, if you use Facebook, is to go to Facebook, and it's called Irritated Genie of Southeast. That's my Facebook page. And this is where we put out the information that is filtered through us that we believe that our people need, that's mandatory for our people to get. We put it through that filter on the Irritated Genie of Southeast Facebook page. Let's talk about Pizzagate. That's a very provocative title, Pizzagate, the new slave trade. So let's just jump right into this. I want to give an outline for this discussion. It's not going to be a short discussion. We're going to spend some time. We're going to take a few breaks just to let your mind process the information, because we got a lot of information to share today. First, we're going to do a brief bio of who is the Irritated Genie of Southeast. Why am I even listening to this brother standing up here talking about something called a Pizzagate? Who is he? Where did he come from? Also, a brief history of the modern homophile movement. We'll explain what that means, why we do it, because in order to understand where we are, it helps to get an understanding of the timeline of how politically we got to this situation that we're looking at now. Also, in order for us to process this, to understand who's in control of what's happening, we need to do a brief discussion on Zionism. In fact, if we don't do Zionism, we actually wouldn't understand it. We're not going to be able to get deep into it, but we're going to do enough that people understand, okay, now we understand who's driving this. Then we're going to take a 15-minute break. Trust me, you're going to want a break once we do that. You're going to say, let me break from this crazy stuff we're talking about here. After the break, after you spend all your money you got with your vendors, after you get some food, we actually have our Everlasting Life team that just came in. Then we're going to talk about the psychology of homophilia. What is the personality? Then we're going to break down Pizzagate. We're going to spend a lot of time just going, what is this? What is this word talking about? What happened that we're having this discussion today? We're going to take one more break, because we're going to need a break after we show you the stuff that's going on at the highest levels of government in this society. And then we're going to come back and finish with the most important piece, which is, what does this mean for black people? And then what do we have to do as black people worldwide in order to save ourselves and preserve African life in the 21st century? So let's talk about a little bit about the background. Who is Irritated Genie of Southeast? Ayo Kimathi. I was born in 1973 right here in Washington, D.C. I went to Green Elementary School, Ann Beers Elementary, Brown Junior High School. Went to ninth grade pre-engineering at Dunbar Senior High School, and also attended the YES program and graduated from the YES program at UDC. 10th through 12th grade, I went to Concord Academy, which is a private institution high school in Massachusetts. 1991, I went to Hampton University, and I graduated 1995, the top of my finance class at Hampton University. I don't know how relevant that is, since I never worked in finance. but yes, sir. 1995 to 2003, I worked for the Department of Navy in government contracting. So I was doing government contracting coming out of college, working for the right here on M Street. 2003, I retired. I said, I got to go write this book, because I saw what was happening. So let me write this book. And then by 2005, we printed the book, War on the Horizon, Black Resistance to the White Sex Assault. 2009, I did not recognize, I didn't even know about something called bootlegging at the time, 2003. But I figured that I'd be able to make a living off the work I was doing, but we were getting bootlegged out of New York like you can't possibly believe. And we actually found out, we went up there one time and saw it, and like they was making, like in 2 hours we stood there, they made like a couple $1,000s selling our stuff. And we weren't making anything. And so by 2009, you know, I didn't want to lose my house. I've been pulled before, and I did not want to go back again, and so I landed a job here at ICE, Immigration Customs Enforcement, which is the old INS, and they put that under the Department of Homeland Security, and I went back into government contracting. 2010, because of some issues I was having there, I ended up as a small business specialist at ICE, and then 2013, I was fired by ICE. Now, we don't know why they fired your brother, but they claim they had a good reason. I don't know if I agree with them.
We need warriors, militant kickers. His name is Io Kamathi, 39 years old, and what's troubling many is that he's a federal law enforcement employee with the Department of Homeland Security in Immigration and Customs Enforcement.
That's how we gonna put a foot in this cracker's ass and bring an end to him on planet Earth with black male aggression.
But it's his moonlighting videos on the internet that are attracting attention.
Ain't nobody gonna be allowed to confuse us and make us think that when we see a black man that's a warrior, that we looking at a homo, and when we looking at a homo that's talking black talk, that we looking at a black man.
His website called War on the Horizon says its purpose is preparing black people for an unavoidable clash with the white race.
He's propagating some serious hate, including the mass extermination of whites. He's got anti-gay, anti-Semitic material on there. It's really, really extreme.
The liberal-leaning Southern Poverty Law Center says Mr. Kamathi is the individual known on internet web videos as the Irritated Genie, a fiery black nationalist.
No, brother, we mad at the white boy. That's okay.
And while there are thousands of hate videos and websites, what makes War on the Horizon different is the apparent connection to a government employee.
You can't, as an employee of DHS, just do whatever you want. You have to report this kind of material, given the sensitive nature of the law enforcement work.
ICE put out a statement. ICE does not condone any type of hateful rhetoric or advocacy of violence of any kind against anyone. Every ICE employee is held to the highest standard of professional and ethical conduct. Accusations of misconduct are investigated thoroughly, and if substantiated, appropriate action is taken. But both left and right have strong reactions, including Sarah Palin, who called it unflipping believable.
We reached out to Mr. Kamathi both on the phone today and by email with no response. He apparently wasn't at work. Government employees in these types of situations have to get clearances for outside activities, but the Department of Homeland Security would not comment when we asked whether Mr. Kamathi had fully disclosed the nature of his outside activities. And so far, no indication from the government that he's been suspended or placed on administrative leave.
I have a feeling they'll be looking into this one pretty thoroughly.
Yes. So I just played that and said, I don't know that anybody will ever have a chance to do this, but never, if you can help it, have anybody else interpret to people who you are. They would call me after they put these particular clips. I don't even know where they find half of these clips. I wouldn't like this person if I saw it, but bottom line is, I was fired in December 2013. But more specifically, we want to know, like, who is this Irritated Genie, a Southeast character? The first time that I remember hearing anything about sexual abuse, I was in fifth grade, I was in Ann Beers. The sister sitting next to me said to me in a conversation we were having that her uncle had had sex with her. And you can imagine in fifth grade, it was too much for me. I locked it out of my mind. And until I got like 20-something years old at a club and I saw her again, it jumped back into my mind. So that was the first memory I had of ever hearing that. In 10th grade, when I was at Concord, Massachusetts, when I had a good friend, it was my best friend there. She was a Jamaican sister. She told me a story that set my life on this particular course that we're on. She told me about being in Jamaica, and one of her family members, I think she was 8 or 9 or something like that, raped her. And it just, like, it did something to me. I just didn't think that anybody could do something like that. And it bothered me so badly that from that point forward, I said, you know what? You know, it opened me up. And everywhere I went, sisters just started telling me. And it was very similar. They said, I've never told anybody this. I don't know why I'm telling you, but I'm telling you, you're the only person I've ever told. And I heard this to this point. I've heard it so many times I couldn't count. Maybe 1,000, maybe 500. I don't even know. But it set my life on a course of path saying, this has got to stop because nobody should be violating children. They're innocent. 1994, I joined an organization called Positive Comedic Visions. Positive Comedic Visions is a proactive, community-based, African-centered movement committed to the total self-determination and empowerment of black people throughout the world. 1997, I went on my first trip to Africa, went to Senegal. Also, I began lecturing on the feminization of the black male and predators in our midst about sexual abuse because, again, this was something that was very near and dear to me from the people that I had met and had told me what was happening to them. 2009, I left and started my own organization. This is War on the Horizon, which you see behind me, because I realized that it was time, I felt like, for something that I was born to do it the way I thought it should be done, no matter what the risk was. 1997, the reason I show this is just something, another landmark moment in my life. When I went to Senegal, you go through Gori Island. That is the single point where more of our ancestors, the last point they saw in Africa before them being kidnapped and dragged to the Americas. And when I got into the end of it, there's a room before you leave where they give you a little lecture, and there was a picture of a black hand holding a white hand there. And I asked one of the Senegalese brothers what it said, because I was just shocked. And he told me that through it all, we have to love one another and stand together, or something like that. And I didn't know I had that much emotion in me as a man. I didn't really know. I literally had to run to another room because I fell on my knees and I was crying. Because I said, our people are crying for extermination. I said, the fact that after 500 years or so, we've gotten our mind conditioned well enough to be brave enough to return home to the African continent, and the greeting we get is that the brothers and sisters who were not kidnapped and were able to stay are still in love with the individuals who got us kidnapped and stole us away from the first place and put us through the torment we went through. And I said, if somebody doesn't do something to take the love out of our heart for those that are exterminating us, we're going to get exterminated without a fight. And I said, for the rest of my life, I'm trying to go into the African mind and say, no, love your brothers and sisters. That hand should be a black hand from anywhere in the world, but don't love the people that are killing us, if you want to call them that, with what they do to us. So that was another landmark moment in my life. 2015, we said, yeah, we got War on the Horizon. That tells our people what the problems are in the African world community. But what about what we stand for and what is our identity? What do we have that grandma not gonna come join War on the Horizon unless she really, like, grandma was out there fighting with the Panthers or something. What can we have that all of our people can say, this is something I can be with and I can support? And so we came together and we created the Straight Black Pride Movement. We founded that saying three basic principles to bring our people together. We don't wanna know your religion. We don't wanna know your political affiliation. Look, if you straight, and that means a consenting man with a consenting woman, we don't consider a rapist straight. We don't consider a pedophile straight, no. A consenting man with a consenting woman. And then for us, that means black too. We saying a black man with a black woman, because there's another way you can get it wrong. You can be a man with a woman, but if you're not a black man with a black woman, brother, you done messed up. I can tell you, I'm married. I'm telling you, brother, you messed up. Trust me. Any other brothers in here can confirm with me, brother, if you ain't got you a black woman, you messed up. Yeah. And sister, if you out there letting the world drag you in and you going with anybody other than a black man, I know we not in the best condition, but sister, you're messing up. Get back with your brothers. Am I right, sisters? That's right, all right. So, of course, again, as a brother is known to be, I caused a little bit of controversy. I was invited to a place called Bermuda to do a basic lecture on preserving black culture and history. And I guess the rest is history. 2015, August, we launched the Straight Black Pride Movement, went to Bermuda in September 2015.
Come on, come on, come on.
Sing a song.
Yeah,
full of the faith that the dark past has taught us.
Come on, come on.
Sing a song.
Yeah.
Full of the hope that the present.
Yeah.